As we said at the top of the show, sometimes it takes a while for those big gears of the legislature to start turning in Santa Fe. The session is now closing the books on its second week. It's amazing. For our panel, just an overall question, the first being, what's really gaining traction, John, at this point? Is it the governor's agendas? I mean, it's very early, certainly, but the Democrats have come out with an interesting jobs plan. What's starting to get the scuttle moving up there?
Yeah, I mean, I think this jobs program, because it's germane, we have to remember that this is a 30-day session. So although the governor has the ability to add things to the call, that the revenue type items are the ones that are most likely to actually get vetted. And so I think especially, you know, it's a bit of an arcane issue, but it goes to Tom's discussion of small business, this issue of pyramiding gross receipts tax. A lot of times small businesses wind up being affected by multiple gross receipts tax on certain things. You know, business A sells to business B, and then business B sells to business C, and you get a pyramiding of taxes going on. And that seems to me like something that could really be addressed, because I think it's something that the governor wants to address and that the Democratic leadership also wants to address, and it's an important issue.
Is there a stark difference with Mr. Keller's bill, his jobs bill? Is there a marked difference to you? I mean, there's a lot of tax breaks in that side of the ledger as well.
Well, I mean, I think that there are differences. I mean, like on this pyramiding issue, to some degree, the Democrats are trying to one-up the governor on the pyramiding proposals and see if we can't cut additional taxes. And so there's a little bit of games playing going on with that. I'm trying to who has the strongest. Mm-hmm. But there's definitely a different emphasis. I mean, the governor's jobs program that she's trying to run through the legislature is much more focused on kind of tax credits, where at least on the Democratic side, there are some increased infrastructure spending and things like that that are a little bit more direct. And so you can see a debate developing between the kind of tax cut only crowd, which is where the governor's coming from, and the Democrats that are a little bit more on maybe some infrastructure spending and that kind of thing.
And on that discussion, where does that sit? What John just mentioned, Brian, where does that sit when you look at the governor's proposal? There's some stuff in there for small business, certainly. We talked about it here last week. How does that match up with the Democrats' plan? Is there something markedly different here?
Well, I just think it doesn't go far enough. I think the governor's the governor's plan definitely goes as further than the Democrats' plan in the Keller bill.
Gotcha.
And I think the governor is doing a good job starting the discussion and getting it moving. And I think in addition to the jobs plans, she's also working on the driver's license issue. And I think now that we're starting to see two bills introduced because of that, I think we're starting to see some real movement there as well. And Democrats and Republicans and obviously the independent in the state house recognizing that that's going to be a big issue this year. So
it's amazing how we refer to the independent in the state house. Everybody knows who it is. It's
absolutely
some mysterious thing. On those license bills, your sense of the differences between the two, the governor's back with basically the same bill, but there's another compromise, so to speak.
It's unfortunate because, you know, now that's bogging everything down again. And it really isn't germane because everybody needs to be focused on the budget and helping small businesses. You know, I think that we'll end up seeing a compromise bill come through. You know, I think what we've seen in Arizona with, you know, a lot of the equalization, if you will, that, you know, both sides on this particular issue are really pushing the extremes. And so I'd like to see, you know, maybe something that has a driver's license is only good for New Mexico. You know, because it isn't like citizenship, which is a privilege. It's a legal obligation. And, you know, a lot of folks are really making it to be a lot more than it really is.
I like the way you parse that. That's an interesting point there. Sophie, your thoughts on licensing. I got another one for you after that.
Well, I think that as interesting as the proposals are, I actually think that neither of them is likely to make it either out of the Congress or out of the legislature or past the governor's desk, and that's I think a disappointment for many people. But to Tom's point, you know, our economy is so pressing, and the session is so short. I mean, halfway through, and we can't really say what's going to be accomplished here. It's a little bit worrisome. I'd like to pick up something about the gross receipts tax issue that I think has sort of gotten lost. Although I trust legislators from around the state will start to pick this up. The small communities of New Mexico really rely on gross receipts income, and they are already hurting. They are already having a hard time running government throughout the state. And to the extent that the legislature decides that they want to cut back on gross receipts revenues, because that's what ends up happening, they need to find a way to help fund those small communities that are going to struggle even more. And I think that to the extent that they can provide construction projects, public work projects in far-flung parts of the state, that will do a lot to help stabilize those communities as well. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, I think there's a tendency to kind of look at the state from the Albuquerque perspective, the Santa Fe perspective, perhaps the Las Cruces perspective.
Fair.
But Springer, Roy, smaller communities throughout the Raton, they're all going to need the money, and taking it away is a tough thing.
Ethics. We've got some ethics bills out there.
I believe that ethics
is there a proper connection here? You know what I mean? You know, if you're going to be in here...
Between funding and ethics?
Yeah, we're trying to find a way to disengage from a lot of things.
I think it depends on who you talk to, because there certainly is this sense that without proper ethics rules, deep pockets are going to continue to set the priorities for our legislature and are going to have a disproportionate voice in Santa Fe. And so to the extent that that's a concern... yes, I think there is a tie between ethics and our budget. Whether the legislature is going to break out of the logjam that they've had for as many years as I can remember on ethics issues, I don't know that I see it happen.
We're going to pick that one up. But our correspondent Gwyneth Dolan was at the Capitol this week and found the executive director of Think New Mexico, that's Fred Nathan, and his think tank are focused this year on reforming the Public Regulation Commission.
Is the executive director at Think New Mexico, a nonpartisan think tank here in Santa Fe. You've been working a lot on PRC reform for months, if not years now. Right. Give us a general idea of why you care so much about the PRC.
Well, it's the most powerful state regulatory agency in the country with the fewest qualifications. Currently, you only need to be 18 years of age, lived in the state for a year, and not be a convicted felon to serve on the PRC, and we think it would be better to streamline the PRC and focus on its core function, which is regulating utilities, and also to increase the qualifications, because those are essentially quasi-judicial judges, and we think they need more qualifications than what they have right now.
And those qualifications seem pretty minimal, but apparently they're a problem.
They are a problem. In fact, they've tripped up two commissioners in the last 2 years who have had to be removed essentially for committing felonies, Commissioner Sloan and Commissioner Block.
And several of the commissioners don't really have any relevant experience to the job.
That's right. And we think that's really important that they have a background in law or accounting or engineering or business to be better able and more suited to do their jobs.
One of the bills you guys are supporting would also move some of the business of the PRC to other areas of state government. Tell me about some of the things you would move out of the PRC.
Great. We have got two constitutional amendments, House Joint Resolutions 16 and 17. The first one would move the Corporations Bureau out of the PRC and move it to the Secretary of State, which already does some registration and reporting for corporations. And 35 states already have a one-stop shop at the Secretary of State's office. So we think it'd be more efficient and it'd be easier for businesses, and particularly in this climate when we're trying to create jobs, to make it a little bit easier for business. And they've had a lot of problems at the PRC in terms of collecting the paperwork and turning it around quickly.
Insurance regulation is the other area. Part of your argument for moving insurance regulation out of the PRC is you say there's been too much political influence over the insurance superintendent. What do you mean by that?
Well, I think, you know, we've had a parade of superintendents of insurance. In fact, last year, in a four-month period, we had five different superintendents of insurance. And that really doesn't serve the people of New Mexico very well. And we've had a lot of resignations over political allegations and other things. And we think that office needs to be stabilized with one superintendent of insurance who has some direct accountability to the people.
So these are not bills that would become law, but resolutions that would go to the voters as constitutional amendments. Are you feeling positive about them making it out of here and to the voters?
Yeah, we're delighted. We've got sponsors now with leaders from both parties carrying all three of our House joint resolutions, and Senator Lopez, who is the chairwoman of the Senate Rules Committee, agreed yesterday to carry the bills once they reach the Senate, and we've lined up some Republican leaders like Senator Bill Payne of Albuquerque to help in that endeavor. So it's looking good, but as you know, Gwyneth, from covering the legislature, nothing's ever certain around here, but hope springs eternal, and we think we'll get them on the ballot and that your viewers will have an opportunity to vote on each one in November.
Interesting. Tom, you know, what he's in essence talking about here, Fred, is getting a constitutional amendment out to the voters. Mm-hmm. It's a very interesting turn of events. Is he quite right that it could in fact pass, or is this something that could get
torpedoed? I think the general public thinks that, you know, what's happening at the PRC is just a joke anyway. Mm-hmm. And even back when it was a corporation commission, I think the kiss of death was the fact that he's using the talking points that every lobbyist and organization uses up there. We have leadership from both sides working with us on this particular issue. Which means it'll be taken hostage in the final hours, isn't good. Yeah. I like the idea of breaking insurance away and really doing the common sense type of items as far as sending the investigative items to the Attorney General, mm-hmm. Sending transportation items to the Transportation Department. All that stuff makes sense, and I just haven't seen a whole lot of that coming out of the PRC.
Yeah, Sophie, this I'm looking at the House resolution here, and just to be clear, this does not go into effect until 2014,
right,
if these changes in fact do happen. But Pierre, you have talked quite stoutly over the weeks about PRC reform. What you're reading in this bill, does this get to some kind of resolution?
I think it's a good step forward. One of the real challenges is that because it requires a constitutional amendment, people don't like to have to go through that too often. Mm-hmm. On the flip side, there can be a tendency on the part of legislatures to say, hey, constitutional amendment, voters will vote for it. We don't have to fully vet it and make sure that it's the perfect bill. The things that I really like, the mm-hmm. idea of putting corporations under the Secretary of State, a huge advantage. Right. And one of the real problems that we have with the PRC is that you're asked to, as a commissioner, to be an expert in too many things once you get into the job, but you're not asked to be an expert in anything before you get the job. And I think that's a real challenge.
Well, interestingly, in the bill, I'm trying to find this from my man John, it was a certain level of education, but then also 5 years of relevant experience as determined by some mysterious group of folks in Santa Fe who knows how these things work. But we've talked about this at this table before. Do qualifications automatically have a good result attached to them? Whatever. I mean, this is automatic.
I really like, first of all, Fred Nathan has got a great deal of experience himself. And
sure.
So the ideas that he's putting forward through Think New Mexico they're excellent. And of all the ideas, I think I support everything that Fred was talking about in that clip. But I'm a little leery about the qualifications because although very well-intentioned and it makes a lot of sense, mm-hmm. and it's certainly true, as Sophie said and as Fred said in the clip, that you have to master, utilities and insurance and mm-hmm. And a whole range of very complicated regulatory matters. And so you would like to have qualifications there. But the reality is we don't have qualifications to be president of the United States. And it's just not something that I think you can pass a law mm-hmm. that says people who run for office need to be really smart and qualified and have it work.
Sure.
And so as a result, there's going to potentially be litigation over whether somebody can run. It doesn't seem to be the way to solve the problem. The other thing mm-hmm. is that the structural problems with the commission are really where we've had issues. They have too much on their plate. And that's where the solution needs to be.
Interesting. We're back in a moment with a program looking to solve many of the same problems lawmakers are, but outside of the Roundhouse.